Hello, gorgeous authors. It's Catherine here, and today I'll be talking about how to make your book bestseller. So the first thing you have to ask yourself is, do you want to be your seller? Oh, look, I can see hear myself talking. The first thing to ask yourself is, do you want to be or do you need to be a bestseller? And this is a pretty interesting question. It's always nice to be recognized at being the best at something, so that's a nice thing. I think it's a bit of a nice to have. For a lot of people, an Amazon bestseller is definitely nice to have. But for some people, maybe they don't take it that seriously because they know that certainly in some categories, as you'll find out today, it's easier to get bestseller status than one might think. And therefore, do people really value it? Being a New York Times bestseller, a USA Today bestseller, or Financial Review, Wall Street Journal bestseller, whatever, all of those obviously have a lot of credibility, although there's sometimes controversy about how those things actually come about. But these things actually is what they still use for getting bestseller status on those big lists as well. But obviously there's a lot more money involved and a lot of moving parts and publicists and publishers. So there's a lot going on at those high levels, but they do employ these same sort of tactics just at a higher level. So, being a bestseller, as I said, is a nice to have. If you're using your book, like your self-help book, business book, memoir, as part of your business as a tool, then having bestseller status isn't really a make or break thing because your book will be an ongoing tool that you'll use over 12 months or 24 months as part of an overall marketing plan. And therefore, the bestseller status, might not really be a big issue. The book itself is actually the draw card, the thing that gives you credibility that opens doors of opportunity. So with all that being said, if you do want to be a bestseller, let's talk about how to do that. So number one is not to leave this until the end. This isn't something that you can just whip up in a few days and all of a sudden like, oh shit, I want to be a bestseller. What do I do? You need to do this over months of time, and really you're doing it alongside writing your book. Now, ideally you've already got an audience. So if you're running a business and it's going well, that's the time to write a book. It's not necessarily the best time to write a book when you don't have a business yet, when nothing's really working. It's not like a beginning thing. It's more something you employ when you've already got an audience and you're already making money, and this is a tool you're going to add to take you to that next level. So ideally, you've already got some sort of audience and you're just going to build upon that. But either way, you need to be doing this along a period of time while you're writing the book, before you're writing the book, and you build that audience and then you engage with them along the way so that when your book comes out, that's when people are buying it and reviewing it and all of that. So as I said, all of these things are not things that you can plan, are not things that you can just do with no notice. Some of them are actually months of planning. So let's talk about those. The first one is marketing with your community. Now, this means that instead of waiting till your book comes out and then saying, hey guys, I've got a book, buy it, keep them informed of the journey along the way. So, I'm writing a blog post about this, which I will put up on my page and in the group and all of that. But basically, the examples might be, hey guys, I had a, working on my book called blah, blah, blah. Or if you don't have a name for it, just say working on my book. Had a good writing session today, selfie of you writing, or, had writer's block today, it was terrible, selfie of you frowning. Or had writer's block, went for a walk on the beach, had writer's block, went for a ride around the block. Anything that you can write about with your writer's journey, just put it in there. Like you talk about or journal anything else that you're doing in your life on social media, make the book part of that. You might, if you're working with a book coach like myself, you might say, had a great session with my book coach today, or here's the homework my book coach gave me, or, working at this coffee shop today on my book, or I needed some coffee today, and or this coffee was so good that I wrote a whole chapter in one sitting. Like anything that you're doing about the book, put it onto your social media, whatever platforms that you're on. Keep people informed of the writing journey. This is so important because people don't see that you're marketing to them. They just see that you're telling them about your life. And the thing you're doing in your life right now is writing this book. So it's important because when it comes time to sell, these people feel invested in your journey. Have a book cover competition when the time is, when the time comes and you're choosing book covers, get them to vote on your book cover. Anything that you can do along the way as well, don't only talk about the book in that way. You can talk about the things you're writing in your book. So you might say, writing, working on the chapter in my book about, mindset today, or, whatever. It made me think, you know, mindset's so important because of blah, blah, blah. If you're struggling with XYZ, how about you try ABC? So you're offering value and your expertise along the way. You're giving them an idea of what's going to be in the book, and you're also reminding them that you're writing a book. So there's a lot of ways that you can keep people engaged. You could post about your book every day and be posting something different. So that's the number one thing to do with becoming a bestseller. So that comes in handy later on, as you'll see. Now, the next thing you're thinking about is building relationships. It's obviously with your audience, but the key members of your audience. So the types of people who are saying, tell me when your book comes out, I'll buy it. People will say this, you know, can't wait, that sounds fantastic, can't wait to read your book. Write a list of all of these people. You know, keep a Trello board, keep a spreadsheet, whatever it is that you like to do for your lists. Keep a note of everyone who's interested, because something that's really good for most people is to create a launch team. And a launch team is a group of enthusiasts. These aren't the people you pay. So these aren't like your VA and those sort of people. These are people who are enthusiastic about your book and who want to support you. You're not going to give them a list of jobs to do, because they will lose interest in that very quickly. Your launch team are going to be your champions when the book comes out. So these are people who are going to read it and give you reviews as well. They'll share it with their audiences and they'll be telling people about it. So they're like your raving fans. There is this theory that if you have 1,000 raving fans for your business or for your book, that you can achieve anything, because all you need is 1,000 people. 1,000 is actually quite a lot of raving fans to get, but you need to start with some raving fans, and they can be on your launch team and they'll be invaluable when the time comes. Now, the next thing you want to do along the way is you've got to start looking at reviews. So when your book comes out, something I've mentioned in previous videos is that book sales alone are not going to make you an income. Okay, so if you've seen my other videos or read my blogs, you'll know that your income comes from the things around the book, like raising your prices, getting paid speaking gigs, things like that, or using your book as a basis for workshops, you know, whatever. Now, book sales, you still want to make book sales. And if you want to be a bestseller, obviously you have to make a bunch of book sales in a period of time. So something you need to be doing is getting and organizing reviews. So many reviewers, if they're sort of not professional reviewers, they might be doing it on top of a job, for example, but kind of review enthusiasts, some of them need a couple of months' notice because they've got so many books to read. You know, this might not be the case with certain genres in self-help. It's certainly the case with fiction. But some of these reviewers need quite a long lead time. So you don't want to be emailing a reviewer and saying, my book comes out next week, can you review it? It's just not going to work. So this is something you need to start looking at and building your lists ahead of time. Now, there are lots of different ways you can get book reviewers. Obviously, you ask your family and friends, you've got your launch team, and that might be a guaranteed 2 or 3 people, you know, however big your launch team is. Family and friends, to be honest, are usually pretty slack in giving reviews, even if they promise you, because they've got to read the book. And the other thing is, Amazon actually go through and delete some of the reviews if they think that they're fake. So definitely don't buy reviews on Fiverr and all of that. Don't even bother, they'll delete those. But for family and friend reviews, they sometimes delete reviews if the person's Amazon account is registered at your address or if they have the same last name. Like, there's a bunch of things. So don't rely upon family and friends, because those reviews can be a bit touch and go even if you get them. So book reviewers, how do you find them? It is a long process. Okay, so one of my partners who takes care of launch and promo, this is something that he advises people on, to try and help you get them and that sort of thing, because it is a long process. Amazon have a list on their site of their top 10,000 reviewers or something, but you can't filter them. It's a bit painful. I have found before, which I couldn't find today when I was checking this, but I have found that there was a place that you could download, like you could export the names into a spreadsheet, which obviously helps. But they have top 10,000 reviewers, because some of these people love having their name out there, you know, as a reviewer. And you can go through these lists and find people who do your genre, only approach people who do your genre. Often they might have just their website. So you have to individually go onto each person's website to see what their criteria are to review your book. They'll say what the lead time is, what they want you to put in the email, what information they require. Something that is totally against Amazon policy is you can't offer any kind of incentive for reviewing. You need to be able to give them the option of doing a positive or a negative review, although most reviewers won't post a negative review. They'll contact you and say, sorry, I'm not going to review it because it was shit. You also can't even give them a gift card to buy the book. You actually have to provide the book for them. Now, I'll get into some of the tricky things around that in a second. But basically, book reviewers, you can find them through the Amazon site. You can also Google book reviewer genre, you know, whatever your genre is on Google, and find some reviewers. Again, start building out a spreadsheet or a Trello list, and, you know, a very small percentage will actually do the review based on how many you find. So it's really a bit of a numbers game. You know, you might find 200 and approach 200, you might approach 300, and maybe you end up with 10 reviews, 15 reviews, something like that. Obviously, the more intriguing your book, the better chance you have of making them happen. There is a site called Book Funnel, and you can put your book on there, and it will give you, you can build like a landing page, and it has links and things like that to provide what they call an advanced reader copy or advanced review copy. People call it different things, but an ARC. And that's when you're giving out the book for free prior to your book's release to get those reviews. And it will control them and make sure that everyone has a unique link and that sort of thing, so that they're not giving your copy, your book to pirate sites. My novel, I found a pirate site where something like 3,000 or 4,000 copies had been downloaded in a couple of weeks. So in my first couple of weeks, I actually sold less books than were downloaded illegally. So it happens. You can't really do anything about it. The other thing you can do, put a review request in the back of your book so that it sort of says, hi, if you enjoyed this, can you please do a review? And, you know, over time you'll get some. But because we're talking about the bestseller thing, we're talking about reviews that you really want in that first week. Okay, so you need to arrange them ahead of time, and finding those book reviewers is one of them. You can also do what's called a blog tour. So there won't be one for every single genre, but if you Google blog tour genre name, well, you know, blog tour, self-help, whatever, you pay a certain amount of money to some blog tour organizer who has a list of bloggers who do reviews and things on their websites. And they will put out a call saying, hi, guys, we've got this new book coming up in a few, you know, weeks or months, or, you know, it depends how far in advance they do it. Here's what it's called. Here's what it's about. Do you want to do it? And then depending on how much you pay, you might pay for 5 or 10 or 15. I think with my book, I'd got the gold package or the, you know, platinum package, and I think it was a minimum of 10. And then each of these bloggers will do, maybe they'll do a review, or maybe they'll do an excerpt from the book, or they'll interview you, or they'll get you to do a guest blog. They'll all have different preferences for how they like to do their blog. But this will be all part of a blog tour. And it's one of the best things that I did for my book, because their followers are people who like that genre of book. So blog tours are really awesome. So, yes, you need your book reviews. And the reason you need your book reviews is, when you run ads to your book or you're promoting your book, anyone who's like a cold lead who doesn't know you, when they click on your ad and they click on your book, if they don't see a bunch of 5-star reviews, they're not going to buy it if they don't know you. Or even if they do know you, they might be like, oh, why doesn't it have any reviews? If it's all 5-star reviews, people sometimes can get a bit shady. If it's like 100 5-star reviews and no 4 or 3-star reviews, if you've only got 10 reviews or 15, then having them all 5-star is great and fine. But when you get up there with your amount of reviews, then obviously, you know, a bit of balance is fine. So don't stress over small reviews. But certainly in the beginning, you want to really aim for 10 or 15 reviews in that first week. Now, one thing I mentioned earlier that I wanted to come back to is one of the issues about book reviews with your advanced reader copy. So one of the good things to do with Amazon is to do a pre-sale, which means that your book might be out on a particular date, let's say 30th of June. You can actually have a 3-month pre-sale. Now, when someone buys your book in a pre-sale, they won't get it until the release date of the 30th of June. Now, the good thing about a pre-sale is that anyone who has bought the book in that pre-sale period, on the day of release, on the 30th of June, all of those pre-sales will hit on the same day as sales in that one day. This is how you get, this contributes to you getting bestseller status, right? Because if 100 people bought it, that's 100 sales on the day. That's obviously awesome. So pre-sale is good, and a pre-sale is, you know, a good time to start promoting and whatever. Look, on the downside, most people can't be asked to wait for a book, so they're not really as enticed by a pre-sale because they want it right now. I know that if I have to wait even 1 week for a book, that I'm not really that interested. The only time that works for me is because I have so many books that I think, well, I can't read it before a week anyway, so it doesn't matter, right? So I have like a lineup of books that are sort of arriving all the time over the coming weeks. But for most people, they kind of want instant gratification. But for others, they'll be like, yeah, when it comes out, that's cool. You make your book cheap in the pre-sale, make it 99 cents. You say it's 99 cents, you're in the pre-sale. When it comes out, it's going to be $9, you know, whatever. So kind of entice people to buy it so that all of those sales hit on that day. But remember, bestsellers, your sort of ranking is done per day. So the timing is important, but essentially that first day, it can be hard to get everything to hit on that first day. But in that first week, if you can get as much activity as possible, that's obviously going to be very good. But the other thing with the pre-sale is people can't do reviews in the pre-sale, which is really irritating. There is a little bit of a trick, a bit of a secret trick that sometimes people do. They actually release the print book before the ebook. So they might put the print book out now as a bit of a soft launch and not mention it, but to give the print books away to all the reviewers, assuming they accept print books, because you'll find some reviewers won't accept, they'll only want ebooks and there's all these different preferences. But if you can get a whole bunch of people to get your print book and they do a review on the print book on the day of launch of your ebook, you can contact Amazon and say, hey, I've put up my ebook, can you join them? And they will join your print book and your ebook records, like on Amazon, and then their reviews will be shared between them. So all those print book reviews will actually show up on the ebook. Now, it only takes Amazon usually about a day to do this, so that can happen pretty quickly, and that's a good way of getting some reviews. As a little side note, verified purchase reviews are obviously stronger, like they hold more weight, and they will only be for people who have bought your book through Amazon. But remember I said you can't give away gift certificates to reviewers, so you actually can't give a reviewer a gift certificate in order to buy your book, in order to show up as a verified purchase, so that's a bit shit. But basically, sort of those professional type reviewers, their reviews don't show up as verified purchase reviews. But if someone's written a lengthy review, the audience, you know, doesn't really care that much necessarily that it's not verified purchase. But what happens is you give the reviewers an advanced copy. So say through BookFunnel, that website I mentioned, or, you know, you give them a Mobi or an EPUB or a PDF, whatever it is that they want. You might put it in a Dropbox or something like that and give them a link and just let them read it. What you can do is get people to buy your book for 99 cents, because there are separate lists for free books and paid books. So try and make it a paid listing, like try not to give it away for free if you want those paid listings to appear, like the listings to appear on the paid book section, which is where your book on an ongoing basis will be in, right? I don't think I explained that very well, but maybe make it 99 cents. Get people to buy your book, then give them a free copy through BookFunnel or one of the other, you know, putting it on Dropbox. Say to them, can you please do a review, get it ready. I'll remind you on launch day. On launch day, can you please go in and do the review? Because then they'll have a verified purchase little icon that comes up on Amazon. And then when they do your review, it shows as a verified purchase. So they've already read it a month before, and then basically they just post it on Amazon on the day of release. So that's a really good thing to do. I know I've talked a lot about reviews, but that's because they're really, really, really important. On an ongoing basis, but certainly in that first week, anything that you can do is going to help your bestseller status, because you want people to jump on there and buy it. Now, have I missed anything here for that? Sales, yep, they're verified. Yep, I mentioned that. Okay, now let's talk about something a bit more general with getting bestseller status that is actually the key to getting bestseller status. I should have mentioned it earlier, and that is your categories. Now, typically, Amazon will put you in two categories. So when you set up your book on Amazon, you're going to select keywords so that when people are searching later and you're running ads or whatever, these keywords all contribute to what comes up in people's searches. Now, categories are actually quite hard to find, and there are some secret categories as well that can only be unlocked with certain keywords. Now, Amazon has, if you Google, and I'll put a link into my blog when I cover this as well, but Amazon have a page that actually tells you, here's all your categories. When you click on those, you find these secret categories. It actually tells you what keywords you need to get into that category to unlock it. It's things like, I looked up memoir, for example, and it was sports memoirs, and there's like a separate list for the US and the UK, like, you know, sports memoirs, famous people, or, you know, historical autobiographies. Like, there's all these different categories which probably won't apply to you, but look for your category because there might be some secret categories. And the reason your categories are important is because the category determines how much competition there is to get bestseller status, and that determines how many copies you need to sell per day to become a bestseller. So some categories, you only need to sell 3 books per day to be a bestseller. Like, this is why some people don't really respect Amazon bestseller status, right? Other categories, you might just need to sell 200 a day or 1,000 a day or whatever. Now, there are some calculators out there which claim to tell you how many you need to sell, and, you know, you try them out. You usually have to pay for them. There's, you know, some of them might be $100 or whatever. But what you can do is go in, you start navigating down categories. So you find the broad category, and then you'll click on that and you'll see some drop downs. And then you click on another category and you keep drilling down to find your categories. Keep a list, right? Now, officially, you only can do 2 categories. But once you've listed in a category, and look, Amazon might change this at any time, but once you've listed in a category and that's all saved, and then you actually can go back in and change your category, it actually doesn't take you out of the category that you were in before. It just puts you also into the new category that you've chosen. So you can actually have like 7 or 8 categories. I've heard of books that are in 14 or 15 categories. Make sure you don't bullshit your categories. They actually have to be really, your book actually has to fit into that category. You can't just go putting it in anything. But you can go in, drill down and find the category. Now, when you get to a category, there'll be other books in there. Now, you can see the number one book in that category. When you click on that book, you scroll down on that book page and you'll see, or ABSR or whatever it's called. And this is Amazon's overall ranking of that book. So it might be, you know, that book might be number 2,000, you know, in Amazon's bestseller ranking. In order for you to become a bestseller, you need your book to be ranked 1,999 or better, right? Because as soon as it's better than 2,000, you're going to go above that book, which is number one. So these calculators you can find, you'll be able to put in 2,000 and it will tell you, okay, how many books do you need to sell to be better than that book? So that's why those calculators are handy as a bit of a guide. But you might find a category where the book is number 2,000 on Amazon's bestseller ranking, but you might find another category where the book is number 10,000. Now, obviously, if that book number 10,000 in the Amazon bestseller ranking, you only need to beat that one, then obviously you want to be in that category, and that's where you're probably going to get your bestseller status. Because if that's only ranked number 10,000 or number 30,000 and it's number one in that category, it's obviously not a very competitive category. And all you need to do is sell a little bit better than that. So as I said, some categories you might only need 3 to sell 3 books, and other categories you need to sell 200. So, you know, which one do you feel like you're going to get your bestseller ranking out of? But if you can find, you know, 5, 6, 7 categories, and then you push hard to do sales, the book is sold and the ranking applies to, like, your bookseller ranking will then flow into all those categories. You don't have to sell a book in a particular category. All you're doing is selling your book, and its ranking is attributed in each of these different categories, but it's the same book and it's the same sales. So if you can get 100 sales of your book in a day, you're pretty much going to find a category that's going to make you number one. And then you go and get your screenshot and bam, you're a bestseller. Now, though, for certain categories, it's more competitive than others. And getting 100 sales in a day, by the way, is not necessarily easy, right? This is all going to be marketing. This is going to be all of this stuff. The other things that contribute to it, podcast interviews. If you can get on some podcasts and promote your book, then you want that podcast to come out in the week of your launch. And this is one of the things that my colleague Tyler does with his program, his bestseller, you know, guaranteed money back bestseller programs is arranges podcast interviews for you that all hit on that same week. Getting them to hit on that same week can be tricky though, because it's pretty difficult to tell a podcaster when they put their podcast out. But obviously in your press kit, you'd say, my book's coming out in such and such a week, you know, is it possible? If I'm going to be on your podcast, could we do it that week kind of thing? But ideally you want all your podcast interviews and all your media to come out in that week. And that's how you get all those people listening in that week, and people are being directed to your book, okay, to download. If you can provide an affiliate link to the podcaster, that would be a good incentive for them as well, because obviously anyone from their show who clicks on that link and buys your book, that podcaster is going to get a cut. In fact, you know, you can give affiliate links to anyone you like and use that as part of your marketing plan. So in terms of getting media, I worked as a publicist for 15 years. I had a lot of experience with media. You don't get media by sending out a press release that says, hi, I wrote this book, can you please promote it? Because no media is interested in giving you free publicity, right? Unless you're already famous, right? In which case you're not watching this video. So getting media about your book it's about finding an angle that editors are interested in. And editors are interested if their readers or viewers or whatever are interested. That's going to be not about you, probably, unless it's with your memoir, it would be something about you. Now, for a memoir to get exposure, you need to have gone through something pretty significant. So your average kind of, you know, that sounds terrible, but your average kind of death, illness, struggle story doesn't really cut it for media. The same with getting traditionally published. If you saw my video or read my blog on getting published, publishers aren't interested in any stories that deal with those things that all of us deal with, because everyone deals with death at some point. Everyone deals with illness. They're interested in those sort of sensational stories, right? But for media, with your memoir, it has to be that. But with a self-help or business book, the angle is going to be something along the lines of someone that you helped, what results they got. So if you're a weight loss coach, for example, I've used that example a lot. I don't know, it just comes to mind. If you're a weight loss coach and you had a client who lost 50 kilos or 70 kilos or something like that, then your press release is, you know, Jane Bloggs lost 70 kilos in 10 months by doing this one thing, this one weird tip or whatever that ad is you see on Google, you know, and then basically you explain what she did, how she struggled before, how she finally lost the weight, how she kept it off, how you were the person who helped her, and hey, guess what, you wrote a book. So if you're getting into the media, the lead, like the hook, is that person you helped, and then you and your expertise, which resulted in you writing a book, is like the follow-up, it's not the hook, okay? So message me about that if ever you want to talk media. But essentially what we're talking about here is that your podcast, your media, any of that stuff needs to all hit in launch week, because the more people that see your book in launch week, the more people buy it in launch week. Here's where your bestseller status comes from. Now, social media, so something I mentioned before about building your audience along the way and engaging with your community along the way. Social media obviously is where most of you are going to be promoting your book. And launch week is a great time for that launch team and for your other followers to be talking about your book. Now, if you've got some followers or some connections who you've built relationships with who have a big audience, give them an affiliate link and say, during launch week, can you please, if you want to promote my book, here's your affiliate link, any of your people who buy it. So if you've got someone who's got 10,000, you know, followers or whatever, if they have 50 people buy the book and they get a dollar or 50 cents or whatever, I mean, that's not a huge amount of money. But if they've got massive audiences, or if you give them a bigger percentage, you can choose with an affiliate link. You might choose to give someone a 75% of your book sales of your cover. So your cover price might be $9, $15, $14.99. You give someone a 75% commission and they have a massive audience, they might suddenly have a bit of a reason to promote your book, assuming that they have read it. So affiliate links are great, and these are people you've built relationships with over time who sort of, you know, are aligned with you in some way. That's another great way to get sales in launch week. What else have I got here? I've covered, oh, okay, there's another thing out there, email lists. Now, there are some lists that people sign up to that say, it's like saying, look, I love reading thrillers. So they sign up to a list that every week we'll send them an email with the latest thrillers that have come out that are free or cheap or just fantastic. And look, commercial publishers use this as well. Now, basically in launch week, an email will go out to this list of subscribers that like this particular genre of book, and you want your book to be in there. Now, getting on some of these lists is difficult. So, for example, there's a list called BookBub, B-U-B. It came off this other thing called BookBaby, or it was competitor with them, so they called it BookBub. I don't know. Anyway, you can actually submit your book to BookBub, but they can accept or reject it. So, because some genres are very, very competitive. I think sci-fi or thriller, I can't remember, but their top category, whatever it was a little while ago when I last looked, they have something like 3 million people on their list. So that's a lot of people potentially seeing something about your book if you've written that category. Now, the self-help categories and memoir, whatever, they aren't quite as big, you know, in terms of the numbers, but it still might be 100,000 people or 50,000 people. Like, that's still a lot of people. Usually a book has to be free or cheap. So if you keep your book at 99 cents during launch week, you obviously have a lot greater chance of getting the downloads. Now, that is to help you get bestseller status. Because one of the issues people have with free and cheap books is that person may never read it, okay? So you're not going to get reviews out of those people to help with your ongoing marketing. But in terms of bestseller status, you just want the maximum amount of downloads in that first week. So offering your book for 99 cents for launch week, for example, you just want as many people to buy it as possible, but it's still a paid book, okay? A lot of these types of email lists, what tool I use. Okay, I'm still back on. All right, can I have a thumbs up or a comment? I haven't had any comments, and I would like to make sure Veronica, Courtney, Pauline, I can see some pictures. This doesn't tell me people's names, but of course I know by your profile pictures who you are. I'm going to click on the video but turn it down.
Launch team.
And see if I can see anything. Okay, so now I've forgotten what I was talking about. But anyway, so give me a second. Doesn't matter. I think I've covered pretty much everything. I'm happy to take any questions. I'm trying to think of anything else I may have missed. It will all be covered in the blog. Now, if you're thinking of writing a book and you're very, very overwhelmed, which possibly you are because it's pretty massive, I do have a 45-step book writing and publishing checklist. I'm just going to chuck the I'll chuck it into the comments. I'll put the link in the comments. And you'll have to opt in, to give me your email address so that I know where to send it. And I'll send you this checklist. It's got everything from planning your writing, editing, to publishing and promotion. So everything you need to know in 45 steps is in the checklist. So definitely click on the link if you haven't got that already and download it, because it's going to be really, really valuable if you're writing a book. I'm happy to answer questions at any time. So just message me. If you're in my group, you can ask a question in the group, and that's the Book Writing for Coaches, Speakers and Entrepreneurs. You're welcome to join the group and ask questions in there. As I said, send me a message. But otherwise, download the checklist. I think it'll be very, very useful for you. I'll also put a link to the blog into my group and on my page, as well as my profile, when that comes up in the next couple of days. And that will cover a lot of this in depth and have a few links and things for you as well. But basically, the things we, just to recap quickly, don't leave your bestseller run until the end or you won't get bestseller status. Okay, market with your community, not at your community. So talk to people about your book as you're going, not once you're finished and you just want to sell it to them. So keep people with you on the journey. Build relationships in advance, and that's relationships, people who are your future affiliates, things like that, other people that you can maybe do co-promotions with. You might even join with another author and you can, you know, where they have a book that's sort of aligned with yours. Look at building a launch team of people who are going to buy your book and review it, as well as promote it on their own channels. join email lists where they send out to their to their subscription list books of your genre that are coming out in that week, and make sure obviously it's coming out in launch week. You want to set up your book reviews ahead of time, because book reviews are key when it comes to selling your book to a cold audience. You can set up your book as a pre-order and make sure that even if you're giving people a book, maybe that they're buying the 99-cent copy, which a professional viewer won't do, but people that you know will buy one. You give them the free copy. Once they've bought one and they can prove they've bought it, send them the copy, get them to read it. There's my dog having a nightmare. Or maybe it's a good dream. I don't know. He's barking in his sleep. And then on the book, the day of launch is when they then put their review in, because pre-orders, you can't put reviews in during pre-order time. You can release your paperback book, get reviews on that, and then join that together with your ebook. Get that out before, like 3 months before or 2 months before. And then when your ebook goes live, then you can join those records together and those reviews will show up. Interviews and podcasts, media, arrange those. A lot of them need to be done ahead of time, or they will be done sometimes 3 to 4 months ahead of time. So this is stuff you need to be doing as soon as you're starting your book, if not way before or around the same time. You want your podcast and media to come out on the same week. Obviously, your social media, this is going to be a whole combined plan, months of, you know, promotion and being strategic. So, again, don't leave it till the last minute. Make sure you get your book into multiple categories, because some categories will be more competitive than others. Some will be really easy to get bestseller status. Some will be difficult. So look at all the different – the dog is cute. I'll get him to say hello in a second. Get your book into a number of different categories. And as I said, Amazon have got a page where they've got these secret categories you can unlock with certain keywords in your book description. And otherwise, you'll need to do some manual work. Look, there are some tools around that help you find categories. And again, you have to pay for those. But essentially, you can do it yourself by just finding categories and you keep drilling down. And then you look at who's number one and, you know, what ranking they have. And there are some calculators out there where you can discover how many you need to sell. But get into as many categories as you can. Overall, I hope this has helped. As I said, it's all in the blog. I'll put the link down below right now for the checklist. Thank you for joining me. If you are joining me late and it's not live, feel free to ask questions anyway. Let me get the dog. He'll come and say hello.
Hello.
Hello. Look how cute he is. That's Rocky. He likes to be at my feet all the time when I'm in my office. And if he could, he would also sleep with me. But puppy doesn't allow it, does he, because it annoys him as you wake him up. So bye-bye from me and Rocky. Thank you for joining me. And I hope that I've helped you become a bestseller. See you soon.